Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining me today on this webcast. Our topic for today's session is optimizing your machine learning project lifecycle using MLOps. My name is Archana Krishna, and I'm a senior business intelligence and analytics consultant at Thoroughgood, and I'm joining you today from Philadelphia. If you have any questions on the content covered today, or more broadly about data and analytics, feel free to get in touch via email or LinkedIn, and you'll see those details up on your screen. So here's our agenda for today. I'll start off with an introduction to Thoroughgood. The session is then broken up into two main parts. In the first part, I will introduce MLOps and talk about why we should be interested in it. We'll then look at how MLOps can be implemented on an AWS platform. But first, who are we and what do we do? Thoroughgood is an independent and specialist business intelligence and analytics company with a focus on data engineering, data science, and data visualization. Our approach is rooted in understanding business goals and using the capabilities of technology to meet those goals. So really, customers and business objectives are at the forefront of our approach. We are a global company with offices and consultants in Europe, Asia, and the Americas. We offer a full range of services when it comes to data and analytics. So right from data and technology, strategies and roadmaps, end-to-end implementation of cloud solutions, user empowerment, and analytics services. Our customers are typically multinational blue chip customers drawing from data rich verticals. So a sampling of them you can see on your screen. They draw from a range of sectors, including consumer goods, pharma and life sciences, and the financial services. We are an independent company, and this independence allows us to provide a pretty unique view of how different tools and platforms compare to each other, but also integrate with each other. It also helps us assess what is best suited for a particular customer or requirement. We work with most of the big players in the market and have very strong partnerships with a set of strategic vendors, including AWS and Microsoft. So before we dive into MLOps, let's step back and look and talk about a pretty similar sounding word, and for that matter, a closely related concept, DevOps. This may be a more familiar concept, especially as most organizations have actively embraced the use of DevOps methodologies and tools over the last few years. I've picked out a couple of slides from a webcast that I ran back in December 2019. The topic was adopting DevOps with AWS, in case anyone's interested in checking that out. But DevOps refers to a collection of philosophies, the tools, and the culture that enables streamlining of the software delivery cycle. In today's fast-paced world, DevOps addresses the constant need for responsiveness and enables teams and processes to be more efficient and reliable. All of this leading to a rapid pace of innovation and growth. DevOps processes are geared towards increasing productivity and efficiency in the operational aspects of developing and delivering solutions. Continuous integration and continuous delivery, or CI/CD, is the approach to automating processes to build and deploy solutions. Version control brings in rigor in the way code is managed by leveraging central repositories serving as your primary code base. Infrastructure as code, which has become increasingly relevant within cloud platforms, helps maintain infrastructure resources using code and allows us to help reliably spin up resources across environments and solutions. You can also build in automated test scripts within the CI/CD pipelines to increase the resilience of your application. To support all of these processes, there are several tools available in the market, be it Azure DevOps. There are a range of services within AWS, such as Code Commit, Code Deploy, or other tools like Jenkins or tools offered by Atlassian, for example. All in all, DevOps is very critical, and it's immensely valuable in realizing these efficiencies as we develop and deploy data and analytics solutions. And there are a number of tools that are available to help you achieve all of this. So that brings us to what is MLOps? There is so much excitement around machine learning and advanced analytics these days, and we see organizations hiring hordes of data scientists so they can tap into the value offered by machine learning models. Data scientists are great at building models and generating insights that drive business value. However, the real challenge isn't necessarily in just building that machine learning model. The challenge is in building an integrated machine learning system quickly deploying models to production, and to continuously operate it at a high quality. MLOps is, in a sense, DevOps, but specifically for data science and machine learning. So let's break this down into its components: design, model development, and operations. The first two components here, for the most part, are what you typically associate with data scientists and the process of building machine learning models. The initial design phase consists of defining your use case and getting an understanding of your data. Data engineering is a critical part of model development. It may be that data scientists take a first pass at it, but this is also where data engineers come into play and they get involved to productionize these engineering processes. Data scientists then focus on developing, training, and validating your model. The third component of operations relates to processes to publish and share your machine learning models for wider consumption. All of this at scale. This is really where the similarities to DevOps comes in. So an MLOps framework focuses on the intersection of data science and data engineering, and it aims to improve the delivery of machine learning models by combining these processes of design, development, testing, and delivery into scalable and standardized processes, a lot of it through automation. To really understand how MLOps provides value, let's first get an understanding of the lifecycle of a machine learning project. So once you've defined your business use case and established the success criteria, the process of delivering a machine learning model to production begins with data extraction. So you identify all of the data sets you need and bring them together. These data sets are typically very varied in terms of where they come from or their structure. Next step, data analysis. So you analyze your data to get a sense of the schema, the key attributes, and characteristics that will be important in your model. It also helps you define the type of data engineering that will be required to make your data usable. This activity is commonly known as exploratory data analysis. Now that you've identified how your data needs to be engineered, you actually get to cleansing, transforming, and wrangling your data to create that final data set. You'll also need to split your data into multiple data sets for training, validation, and the final quality testing. In the model training phase, the data scientists implement different algorithms with this prepared data to train machine learning models. Data scientists will typically identify the best performing model using a number of repeated tests. In the model evaluation phase, the model is evaluated on what's known as a holdout test set. So basically a data set that you've separated out right in the beginning and hasn't been involved through the development lifecycle. And you use this to evaluate the model quality. So what you get is a set of metrics that describe the quality of the model. The model is then validated and signed off to be good to go. In the model serving phase, the model is deployed to a target environment and is ready to start serving predictions. So it can be accessed by other users or applications. Now, deployment doesn't quite mean that we're done here. An absolutely critical aspect of this cycle is monitoring your model. So the performance of a machine learning model is heavily dependent on the incoming data. And if that data changes, the performance of your model could be impacted as well. It's therefore important to monitor your performance levels and, if and when needed, trigger an iteration in this machine learning process. So yes, this is not a linear cycle, it's very much an iterative cycle. And what MLOps does is that it looks to automate either a part of or the full cycle. And this very need for an iterative and responsive cycle is where all of the efficiencies are brought in. I've alluded to some of the benefits in terms of automation and efficiency, but let's break that down a bit more. Why should we care about MLOps? What is the value? One of the biggest pain points that I've heard from customers is that, okay, great, we're producing all of these models, but it takes so long for them to be productionized and actually available and consumed by your business users. Any change takes a long time to be reflected. The biggest benefit of MLOps is that it accelerates the business value returned by the machine learning models, and it allows you to quickly respond to changing market trends or data changes. Just fundamentally increases your return on investment. This speed to value is enabled partially by the automation of deployments. As with anything, eliminating manual steps, speeds up the process, and ensures consistent and reliable deployments. Automation also ensures that processes always work in the same way. That is, it's always the same set of steps that are executed, and nothing is missed out along the way. So be it with respect to how data is transformed, how a model is deployed, who it is approved by, or how it's monitored. Basically, all aspects of that machine learning lifecycle. A machine learning project would typically involve data scientists, data engineers, and even ops team members to, say, manage the deployment processes, as an example. An integrated machine ML ops framework allows for greater and smoother collaboration between these different user groups. So everyone has access to all of the components, they use a consistent framework, there are defined processes in terms of how they work on both their own tasks, but also how that fits in within the larger picture. Now, with version control and CI/CD pipelines, so those fundamental DevOps concepts, there is clear visibility and traceability to how models were built, what version of the code was used, the data sets that were used for training and testing, and really when and where it was deployed. So you have that end-to-end picture always. And last but not the least, building in monitoring into the MLOps framework ensures that we're being proactive about mitigating risks. We can build in checks to flag if for some reason the model was unavailable for a period of time, or if the performance of the model is going down. If there is increasing model bias, you can build in checks and balances to react to this. And this way, you ensure that the business isn't adversely affected and that you are being more proactive, responsive, and agile in reacting to some of these issues. So we've looked at some of the benefits of adopting MLOps. As we move on to implementing an MLOps framework, what are some of the key considerations you need to keep in mind? This isn't an exhaustive list, but just a few topics to get started with, and you'll see that they follow the same themes or some of the similar themes that we've been discussing until now. The first one on my list today is maturity of automation. So if you think back to that machine learning lifecycle, there were about 8 stages in that process. There is a decision to be made on which of those steps you would like to automate. Is it just the model training and validation steps, for example? So where the pipeline automatically retrains your model when there is new data, or do you extend it to include the deployment as well? Of course, greater the automation, the more mature your processes are and your productivity increases. Batch and real-time inferencing. It's a fairly obvious consideration when you're designing your machine learning model. So do you want your model to be able to serve predictions on a scheduled basis, or do you want it to serve predictions on a real-time basis, so as and when the user needs it? The infrastructure that you deploy to meet these needs will vary. So for example, APIs or containers for real-time inferencing versus a data store where you may want to store the outputs of a batch inference. Based on this design, your MLOps pipelines will need to be accordingly configured so it meets these infrastructure needs. The ways of working between teams. It's always an interesting topic. So whilst an MLOps framework does enable greater collaboration, you also want to ensure that there are defined and agreed processes relating to who is responsible for each of these steps. When does a model deemed ready to get pushed to this pipeline? What kind of review may be needed? So these roles and responsibilities and the touch points between these different teams need to be clearly laid out so there is clarity around who needs to do what. I mentioned monitoring and risk management as a benefit, but as you think of designing these controls, you'll want to think of the thresholds that need to be defined and the different kinds of risks you want to mitigate. So for example, is it about monitoring degrading performance over a sustained period of time, or do you want to flag every one-off occurrence? The final one I want to touch upon today relates to striking the right balance between automation and manual oversight. Whilst it's great to have a fully automated solution, the more realistic situation is that you will want to build in manual review and intervention. So be it approvals for deployment, or for someone to actually have a look at why the model performance has dropped down before you automatically start retraining the model. Maybe you don't want that always, but there may be different thresholds that you define based on the priority and the significance of that particular business use case. So with all of that background on MLOps, let's move on to the second part of the webcast today, which relates to implementing MLOps on AWS. So Amazon SageMaker is a fully managed machine learning service that is offered by AWS, and it can be used by a range of users, so data scientists and data engineers and others. There are a host of different services to prepare data, build models, train, tune, and deploy your machine learning models as well. As recently as December 2020, there were a total of 9 new capabilities added within SageMaker, and you'll see a number of these green colored new tags on the image on your screen as well. A couple of the newer capabilities are Data Wrangler, which is a visual interface to support data preparation. And another one that I'll call out is SageMaker Feature Store, which basically helps engineers store and share curated data, and it can be used across different workflows. So you get some efficiencies in your data engineering process as well. All of these capabilities seamlessly integrate with each other to provide a comprehensive set of tools to support your machine learning projects. And finally, they all come together within an interactive user interface called SageMaker Studio, which really becomes your one-stop shop to leverage all of these rich and powerful capabilities. I'll now move on to SageMaker Pipelines, which is actually one of the newer services that was released late last year. As the name tends to suggest, it is a purpose-built CI/CD service for machine learning. That is, it allows you to create, automate, and scale pipelines for different stages of that machine learning project. So it's a pretty critical tool to enabling MLOps on AWS. Having said that, before SageMaker Pipelines was available, you could use the likes of AWS Lambda and Step Functions to orchestrate all of the different steps, but this new service just makes things a lot easier. So let's look at some of the key features of SageMaker Pipelines. Obviously, the core feature is the ability to create these end-to-end pipelines for automated and reliable operations relating to machine learning. These pipelines can invoke other AWS services, so be it SageMaker Data Wrangler that I just mentioned, or others like SageMaker Clarify, which helps you detect bias in your models. So what does this mean? It just means that you can manage all of your processes within a single workflow. The model registry allows you to track all of the different versions of the models that have been built. So you can configure your pipeline to pick up a certain version, or say always the latest version. And no matter what, you'll always have a record of all of the different versions of the models that you may have tested. You can maintain multiple environments, so a non-production and a production environment, and have separate workflows for each environment, perhaps with different levels of control. With the integration of these pipelines and a code repository, you can almost draw a straight line between which version of the model was deployed to what environment and when. And you'll always have detailed logs available for every execution of these pipelines and models. And finally, there are pre-built templates that are a great way to easily get started. So it spins up all of the resources that you need for an end-to-end MLOps system, including the pipelines for different stages of that lifecycle, a code repository, and just any other function that you may need. Having said that, you can also create custom templates or use infrastructure as a code, so CloudFormation templates, to define these pipelines as well. So it really depends on what's best suited for your organization. So now just going back to that life cycle of a machine learning project, let's look at what it takes to build an MLOps-based pipeline within AWS for one aspect of this process. So just the model serving and model monitoring aspect of it. As mentioned earlier, the most mature MLOps framework will incorporate as much of these steps possible. But for the sake of simplicity in today's session, we're just going to look at that final few stages. So let's look at what an MLOps pipeline for deployment would look like. Let's assume the model artifacts are available in an S3 bucket and it needs to be retrieved from there. A SageMaker pipeline is effectively an AWS code pipeline based service. So that's basically the same service that you use for your DevOps CI/CD pipelines as well. Within this code pipeline, your first step is to retrieve those model artifacts from an S3 bucket and build it. And here we're using AWS Code Build, again, a standard DevOps tool. So your model artifacts are built and a Docker container image is created and registered within Amazon ECR container registry. In the deploy phase, so you use the previously created container image the model is deployed, and an endpoint is created on Amazon SageMaker. So that's your final touch point for what users would connect to. So your next step is actually to share the model so it can be consumed more widely. And let's say in this case, you want to create an API. A Lambda function is invoked to connect that SageMaker endpoint to an Amazon API gateway. And all of your users and applications can collect predictions using that API as a source. Now your model has been deployed, and your final step right now is to build in the monitoring processes, which is where we leverage Amazon CloudWatch, where all of your logs and tracking metrics get captured here. And you can configure what sort of metrics you want to track as well. Now, let's say you want to retrain your model or just invoke another step based on some of these metrics that you're tracking within CloudWatch, be it related to availability or performance. You can set up a Lambda function to serve that purpose. Now, this is a template for a pipeline to deploy and monitor models. That code pipeline right at the start, it can be set up to be triggered as soon as there are new artifacts available in that S3 bucket. Let's say if there was a change, you can make a trigger based on that, or maybe it's just a manual trigger. But the essence is that once you've set up this pipeline and tested it, it can be used for all machine learning projects across your organization. You may think that there are just lots of individual resources here, but that's really where the predefined SageMaker project and pipeline templates are immensely useful. And you can either use them as is or use them as a starting point to add in your own enhancements. A SageMaker project, and I should just add, is basically a wrapper that contains of all of the different SageMaker pipelines and all its connections to the different resources that you see here. So it's just a container of sorts. So now that was a simple workflow for deploying and serving models. I just wanted to quickly highlight some of the key features of SageMaker pipelines and more broadly MLOps within that framework that we've just seen. So firstly, you can set up that framework for multiple environments, so development and production. They can be managed separately, or you can have some sort of a dependency between them, so one is invoked after the other. You can include approvals in your deployment process, and these are native features that are available within code pipelines. So maybe it needs to be approved by a business representative or an IT lead, or maybe both. It just helps you provide an additional layer of control in your process before deployments and changes are made. Similarly, within the monitoring component of your framework, you can customize that Lambda function to either automatically trigger an action or perhaps just notify a team so there's a manual check involved. So this sort of relates to that consideration that I mentioned earlier in terms of the balance between automation and manual oversight. I guess just wrapping this up, this was a template for deploying models, but there are other templates available for training and validating your model going through to the deployments as well. And if you don't want to use these templates, just remember that you always have the option to customize them so to really make it work for your specific need. So with that, just wanted to wrap up with a quick summary of today's discussion. We started off by looking at what is MLOps. So MLOps aims to optimize and standardize the process of building, testing, and delivering machine learning models. Why should we bother with this? The benefits really include greater business value on all of your machine learning investments, increased productivity, efficiency, and consistency in the way you run your machine learning projects. And finally, if you are looking to implement this on AWS, SageMaker Pipelines is a great offering, and it allows for building of these end-to-end machine learning workflows. You can integrate it with other SageMaker capabilities, and like collectively, it just helps you automate that complete machine learning lifecycle. A final call to action, think about how your organization can leverage MLOps to accelerate the value you get out of your machine learning and advanced analytics projects. Of course, if you'd like to explore how this would work for you, or if you need help thinking through if this might be valuable for you at all, please do reach out. And that wraps it up for today. Thank you very much for joining, and have a good rest of your day.